Hey, kids, this is Mark Arm from Mud Honey.
This is Nicole Alvarez from the world-famous K-Rock.
Hey, I'm James Joseph from James and the Cold Gun.
Hey, I'm Zozier.
I'm Lenny from Black Circle.
Hello, this is David Aberzis.
This is Josh Evans.
This is Charles Peterson.
And this is the State of Love and Trust.
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 A Pearl Jam podcast.
Don't forget to rate, review, subscribe to the podcast wherever you listen. Feed that algorithm.
Welcome, everyone, to another episode of The State of Love and Trust. It's a Pearl Jam podcast, and I'm one of your two hosts, Jason Kerepesi, and alongside me, as always, for the 200th time, Paul.
Can you believe it? Look at us.
Look
Can
at
you
us.
Believe it? Who would have thought? Huh? Who would have thought? Not me. Not me.
There was a time, Paul,
hey,
when...
Salud.
Hey, you know what? Salud. Yeah, to you guys out there for making this happen. Look at that. Woo, vino and scotch.
Look at that.
If you're not watching this on YouTube, then you're missing out on that beautiful moment. But I hope
you know what else they're missing out on? They may have been listening to Pearl Jam at the Forum Arena in Milan back in 2000.
Uh-huh.
Because they might have had this beauty right here, and they might have been thinking to themselves, my oh my, the design of this release, this bootleg, is so interesting. With the typeface and we've got the ape man there.
Oh, the ape man!
And if
that's
only
right.
Someone could capture that design in a t-shirt somehow.
Look at Paul like shilling.
How does that
incredible.
Work?
Incredible. Turn around so we can see your back. There it is.
Yeah, look at that.
The DNA in the back. This is the best part of the podcast for those listening audio only. They can listen to Paul turning around in his chair. That is that's a shirt that we have that is for sale. If you'd like to help fund the show, we sell t-shirts to do that. And that design, like I mentioned it before, but that was created. Well, it was conceived by Paul and designed by Karen Tigerson, and it's lovely. And it's one of the three shirts that we have.
Very grateful.
Well, welcome to the show, guys. This is exciting.
Yes,
I was telling my wife earlier today. You know, I go, babe, you know, for our 100th, you bought us a cake. We had a cake.
Did she really?
Yeah. It was a small one, but it was
How
a nice cake.
How outstanding is that?
And I go,
very nice.
What do we get this time?
Untouched.
She goes, I mean, you got wine. I go, yeah, I poured the wine. You didn't do anything. I guess it's just, you know, ho-hum now that we're just pumping these things out.
Exactly.
It's old hat to
no,
me.
Honestly, it's thrilling. We're extremely grateful. Never thought we would see the day when this little brainchild of yours, Jason, came to fruition.
Well, ours,
I mean, like
really.
You
Come
said,
on.
You know, well, it was
we
ours, but it started off with you saying it'd be really cool if we did a podcast on Pearl Jam.
I say that about a lot of things. It'd be really cool
if.
You
really cool
if. Follow through
exactly.
with 98% of them.
And, you know, one of the very few good things to come out of COVID was the fact that I actually had time to say, hey, what the heck, you know, why not? Let's give it a whirl. And here we are today. So,
yeah. Well, cheers to all of you out there. I don't know if where you've joined this train. It's been a local stop, a weekly local train. This is the worst analogy. It's been a weekly local train for nearly 4 years now. And I don't know where you hopped on. But welcome aboard. If you're new, if you've been around the block a couple of times, we appreciate it. I'm mixing the metaphors. Yeah. It's okay. I've had a half a bottle of wine already, if you couldn't tell. And if you're listening
to
this in the
you
morning,
know what?
That's
you don't need to be half a bottle of wine in, Jason,
yeah.
to feed that algorithm.
That's right.
Okay. So for those of you watching or listening, do us and yourselves a favor. Rate, review, and subscribe on your preferred podcast platform of choice. Feed that algorithm. It feeds the show. And we, in turn, try to feed you and your insatiable need for Pearl Jam and great musical content. That's what we do here.
That might have been the best version of that you've ever done. You saved it for the two.
It just took me 200 times.
All right, let's call it. By the way, if you're watching on YouTube, hello. If you could like this video and subscribe to the channel, that would greatly help us and your fellow Pearl Jam and music fans to find this stuff, because there are a lot of people who, I think Pearl Jam's Instagram has like 3 million people on it. It's like Not all of them know about us. No. Let the gang know, you know? And we can put spotlights on more conversations that y'all are having out there. And we'd greatly appreciate that.
It's about the community.
Yeah, and if you want to be part of an even closer in the community, we do have a Patreon, and it's not just about hanging out, although that's very cool, and we do that in our Discord channel all the time, daily. But we also have a lot of extra content. We've got videos and extra podcast episodes, discounted merch, like what Paul's wearing, and monthly giveaways, Paul. What are we giving away this month in March of 2024?
Well, it looks like this. Oh! How about that, huh?
It's a dark matter single on vinyl. You know, I've got one right here, Paul.
Look at us. Look
you,
at
you
us.
Will, huh? You shouldn't open yours because that's what we're giving away.
I will not.
But the one that I currently own looks like this. It's clear.
Wow.
And it's lovely. And
45.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
By the way, the instrumental, no one's been talking about it, but the instrumental is really cool. And you can hear a lot of cool stuff.
It's a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of fun.
Yeah.
And you know what was even more enjoyable was listening to you learn how to play the instrumental of this song.
Oh, well, you know, I did my best. Ryan's a hell of a teacher. And you know what? We both got a little bit of that wrong. We learned after the fact that, because I was curious about this, that Jeff Ament is playing his 12-string bass on that song. And Ryan...
I did not know
was like, oh, it's, you know, I think someone's got an octave fuzz pedal on. And I go, oh, that makes sense. You can hear multiple octaves of notes. Well, duh, if you're playing a 12-string bass, there's three octaves of a single string. You're going to hear those things.
You are.
You know.
You are.
I don't know how we missed it. But anyways, by the way, we also have these cool stickers right here. I don't know if you can see these.
Yeah. We have stickers.
Oh, you got stickers too.
We even have pins.
Pins.
We have the little pins here.
Look at that.
Stickers, pins. What's happening here?
Oh my God.
What have we become?
This is ridiculous.
What have we become?
We've gone about 7 minutes and we've done absolutely nothing but pat ourselves in the back. It's the best kind of content you can ask for. I'm just kidding. We actually do have some content for you today. This isn't just a shill session. This. Yeah, for lack of a better term. But again, like I said, I am half a bottle of wine deep and I think Paul is near me.
I'm going to have to do what I never do, and that's carry the show, Jason.
Please. I basically set the table, and then you make the entire dinner is what really happens on this show. I do want to point out one thing, though. I am wearing, if you can see this, is an original 1998 Yield Tour t-shirt. You can see how
old it is. Shape.
I hardly ever wear. I bust it out once every few years for a special occasion. And this hat that I'm wearing is the last thing that I've bought from the band when I went to see them in Austin. So I'm trying to combine the worlds here. And you are marketing our beautiful merch as well. So we're really ticking all the boxes here. Should we get to some actual stuff here?
Yeah, people are like, God, would you guys just... People who like us talk about something.
Are like, this is fun. People who are new are like, who the fuck are these people? I apologize. All right. Well, let's talk about Dark Matter. Yeah, we mentioned the single, this thing over here.
Give me some stats, Jason.
Whoo, baby. It is kicking some booty up there, my friend. It is the number one on the Billboard rock chart. First time Pearl Jam has had a song do that. In 26 years, the last one being Given to Fly. Mm-hmm. And that time frame, that distance between number ones is actually the longest time between number ones on the mainstream rock airplay chart in the chart's 43-year history. Oh, my. Lanta. Dark Matter launched at number 46 on the Hot Rock and Alternative Song chart and number 3 on the Hot Hard Rock Songs list. The Rock and Alternative Airplay chart was at number 6. Alternative Airplay was number 18, and the Mainstream Rock Airplay started at 17. Rock Digital Song Sales, number 8, and Alternative Digital Song Sales chart, number 4. It launches highest on the Hard Rock Digital Song Sales list, where it began at number 2.
Oh, my.
There's a lot there. But the biggest point is that it's the band's first number one in 26 years.
That's a big
deal. And, you know, we had the instant reaction viewing party way back when. And then we had the the live reaction to the song slash album slash tour show with Rich and Stip. We haven't really dug into the song too much on what it's really about and music. And we'll do that because, you know, there's going to be a two-part album review episode coming out in a couple of, you know, whenever that, April 20, whatever it is.
Eventually it'll get its own live cut of the week as well, right?
Of course. And somebody actually did ask for that. You know, this the main segment today is going to be a mailbag. The questions that you guys have asked us. And somebody did ask for a lyric of the week for that. And I said, well, what I just said, you know, we're going to have the album review. We'll do a lyric of the week and live cut of the week eventually down the road when we get some live cuts of this thing. So we won't do that today. But Dark Matter as a song and the fact that it's number one to me is, it's a little surprising, but it's also not surprising because it is a song that was produced by Andrew Watt. Andrew Watt has had a history, as we know, of putting out hits, creating hits with artists who make hits, and for the lack of a better term, revitalizing quote-unquote legacy bands. You think about Ozzy's last two records, think about the Rolling Stones' last record, pleasantly surprising to some people's ears, including mine, especially the Stones, I think. And I believe Angry, the Stones single, was nominated for a Grammy. So
yeah,
there's something to be said for what he brought out of them. And listen, when they were talking about how excited they were about this material all of last year, then what we heard coming out of the listening party, you're like, wow, they are really excited. Is this really going to be that good? The people, the casuals seem to agree by making it the number one song in the land.
And I think that's key. I mean, I hearken back to Pearl Jam accepting an award, a Grammy, for Spin the Black Circle. Vitology comes out. What does this mean? I don't know. I don't know if it means anything, right? That was the very memorable and iconic response to that award. And then, of course, Pearl Jam 20, doesn't Stone, like, dig the Grammy out of his, like, garage or something? He's just buried in a closet.
Shelf, and he's like, it's like all it's dusty. He's like, oh, look at that.
There's a Grammy. now, whether or not, you know, they're being cheeky with that or authentic, we may never know. But here's what I can say. And here's why I think this matters. It matters because the success of this song is an indication that Pearl Jam still resonates with new listeners. And I think that's why it matters. Okay. Forget the sales figures. I mean, that matters to obviously certain sectors, but what I think is the most salient takeaway is the fact that Pearl Jam continues to grow as a band. They continue to push the boundaries and the depth and breadth of their own sound. But more importantly, they're reaching new ears because it's not just old fans that are, you know, driving these numbers behind this song. There's a lot of newer folks. And I think it gives rock and roll a platform in a very digital age. And it highlights a gateway into a whole genre of music. Because if you're new to Pearl Jam and you hear this song and you're thinking, wow, that's a pretty cool rock song, and you start diving into the band, that may lead you to eventually dive into Temple of the Dog, and perhaps that sends you down a rabbit hole with Soundgarden and then maybe other bands of the era. You know what I mean?
Especially so, younger fans. Yeah, that's a great point.
Younger fans, exactly. So, I mean, obviously, if you're listening to this or you're watching this right now, you know, you're no stranger to the band and its history and everything else. But I think when we start thinking about, or talking about, I should say, the numbers here, we want to really look at it in terms of the newer Pearl Jam fans, this whole spectrum. And we talk about the bell curve, right? Let's talk about that bottom half of fans that are new to the band and why that matters, why that's important. Because if we believe in this music, if we find it inspiring and affective, then, and who listening or watching right now has not tried to introduce Pearl Jam to somebody who maybe was a casual fan or, you know, hadn't really done the kind of deep dive that we obviously do. So, here's an opportunity now to make that even easier to facilitate, because now people are coming to you, right? Like, hey, man, I know you're a big Pearl Jam fan. I heard that song on the radio. I mean, this happened to me with Dance the Clairvoyants. I had a friend of mine who was not a huge fan of Pearl Jam, really kind of fell out of listening to them in the mid to late 90s, and happened to catch Dance the Clairvoyants at some point. I don't know if it, you know, streaming, Spotify, on the radio somewhere, and in casual conversation with me said, you know, I heard that new Pearl Jam song. It was like, it sounded like a Talking head song, you know. Suddenly we're having conversations, and then, you know, we get together for drinks and a bite one day, and, you know, I give him an opportunity to listen to more songs in the car, and now he's back in the rabbit hole again. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm, so mm-hmm. I think there's a lot to command when you have a new audience listening to you. And so I hope, and I'm sure that the band recognizes that. And so, you know, let's not get so caught up in trying to poo-poo the numbers. Like, it's not a big deal, because I think if we do that, we're kind of missing the forest for the trees. You know what I mean? We're not really seeing the big picture here.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. And the idea that, you know, and I brought up Andrew Watt for a reason, because number one, to Jeff's point, he has an encyclopedic knowledge of the band. He is a super fan like yes. we are. He's going to know, Jeff, you haven't played the 12 string on a record in 30 years. Like, I think some of your really cool stuff comes from that instrument. Maybe we bring it out. Guess what happens? They get a number one hit. Not saying that's the only reason, of course, but like the point is that there is an energy and an excitement from a producer who has the pulse on what works.
Yeah.
In today's musical landscape, with an affectation and an admiration for Pearl Jam's music across the catalog, and is going to be able to highlight those moments for them. Say, guys, these are the moments I think if you highlight in this new music, we're going to reach the people who need to be reached. And that's what we're seeing. That's what we're seeing. I was at a children's birthday party a couple weekends ago, as you do, and because they're every weekend apparently now. That's a rule when you have a grammar school aged child. And he's talking to me about how, you know, he loved the band in the first couple of albums, and he kind of fell out. I'm like, all right, this whole thing. All right, fine. And I started explaining how I have the show and yada yada, and, you know, we celebrate the whole catalog, and, you know, this new song's pretty cool. And he goes, wait a minute, I think I might have heard something. And I go, yeah, what's it called? Dark Matter. And I go, yeah, that's Pearl Jam. He goes, it is. Oh my God, that was really cool. And I go, I know. I know it's really cool. And I'm glad that it got you, because you might be the kind of person who, you know, it hit Vitalogy or it hit No Code or whatever it hit for you and you dropped off.
Right.
And you may have tried to drop back in and just simply honestly didn't prefer what was coming out over the last 20 years. Or you could have been the kind of fan who said, I don't like that. It's not go. It's not even flow. I'm tuning out completely and turning my attention elsewhere and not even giving any of this the time of day because I'm assuming I'm not going to like it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't much care for that attitude, number one. But
no.
If this song, and presumably the rest of this album, can grab the attention of somebody like that and say, hi, we are choosing to make the music that we are making. And right now we're choosing to make this music. And if you like this, you might actually like some of the other stuff we put out. You just didn't realize it because you wrote it off.
Mm. Right.
It's like a gateway drug, to your point.
It is. Yeah.
So listen, I went over the song with Ryan Lent. You alluded to it earlier. It's not complicated. It's really quite simple. I mean, Stone is stealing one of the riffs from Jimmy Page, which has been his thing for 45 years. I mean, there isn't anything.
Remember all the controversy with that, with Given to Fly?
Well, yeah, and Mike too, to your point.
Yeah.
And there is nothing new about this song per se, but it's an amalgam of the best versions of what they do with their influences wrapped into one under the Andrew Watt production banner.
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, the production value on this is very different than what we've heard from them in the past. So
yeah,
I think it sounds energized. It sounds revitalized. It sounds charged. And I think that definitely matters. Because, you know, if Pearl Jam releases a song and somebody says, it kind of sounds dated, well, that colors the whole experience, colors the whole album, you know? Whereas if you get something that feels fresh and new,
it feels real like fresh, man.
It really does. I agree.
And even though you get, like, the classic McCready, just face melting, you know, pentatonic blues licky solo thing, like, of course. And listen, Ed lyrically, I think, is already picking up where he left off with the heights of Gigaton with Comes and Goes, yeah, and other great, you know, whoever said, and like other really quirky references. I mean, Sleepsack in a Bivouac, Vivisection, all those lines like that he had from Gigaton. This one, and there's actually a Facebook post on one of the groups that had a picture of the Suicide King, you know, of a pack of deck of cards, oh, you know, the One-Eyed King.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's the King of Diamonds. And what's one of the lines there is King Diamond to discard. It's just like, and so then there was a conversation of what's the lore of the One-Eyed King, the Suicide King. What's like, isn't there like a backstory to what that card means? And then he uses the word discard, and like, that's one line.
You're going down a rabbit hole, aren't you?
I am, but like that
come back, Alice. Come back.
It made me start making me think, like, oh man, there's probably even more that I haven't really, really looked at yet. And thankfully, yeah, we will look at that when we do our review in probably about a month's time. But sure, anyways, I'm super excited for the guys. I'm stoked for them. I'm stoked for the label. I'm stoked for Andrew. I'm stoked for us that we have, mm-hmm, a song that is getting people super excited. And that's not to say that the last album or the previous album didn't have exciting moments, but there seems to be a little bit different energy this time around. And there's yeah, a zzz, you know, zipping through the community right now.
Mm-hmm. Could not agree more.
You know, I put it out there on the social medias that we are doing this mailbag thing. Send in your questions. Let us know.
I can't think of a better way to spend our 200th episode. That, you know, we spent 200 episodes building and contributing to and participating in community. And I think an episode like this is an opportunity to celebrate community and to give voice. And I'm excited. Can't wait.
Well, we've got a number of questions here from across social media. As I said, we're going to pick some at random here. Paul and I will alternate, and I don't know what we're going to choose. There's a bunch here. So, Paul, do you want to start off with one? Do you want to team me up with one of these fabulous questions?
Yeah. Let's go with this. This is from Ryan on Instagram.
Okay.
So Ryan asks, do you think that the best Pearl Jam albums are the ones where Eddie writes 90% of the lyrics? Best Pearl Jam albums when Eddie writes 90% of the lyrics.
Okay. I'm going to consult my handy dandy master cheat sheet that we have, where
does Ryan mean 90% of the lyrics? Because by and large, I think Eddie generally does write the vast majority of lyrics on every album. The compositions, though, the songwriting, the music has become a far more democratic process and a far more collaborative process than
so,
I think it had been.
I mean, he does say lyrics. So I'm gonna
he does.
I think what he means is, I mean, 90 is a number he threw out there. My guess is what, mm-hmm, he means is, you know, you look at 10 and you look at Verses and you look at Vitalogy, he wrote, Eddie being that he wrote every single set of lyrics. Starting with No Code, Stone wrote a couple. Then with Yield, Stone wrote two, Jeff wrote two, Ed wrote the rest. Binaural got real wild. Riot Act got even more wild with Matt dropping in two writing credits for lyrics, and it kind of fluctuated from there. Actually, Lightning Bolt was all Ed. So to his question, do I think the best Pearl Jam albums are where Ed does the vast, vast majority as opposed to sharing the load? I'm going to lean toward yes, but only because most albums are mostly Ed. But, you know, there is also the fact that, you know, look at 10 and Verses Vitalogy, some would consider those the three best or three out of the four best. And you look at Lightning Bolt, which a lot of folks put at the bottom of their lists, and those are all Ed only records. But then you have Binaural, like I said, or Riot Act, or Yield, where there's a lot of collaboration lyrically. I think it's whatever suits the album. I think if it suits the music of the song, it is what it is. You know, I don't think that Nothing As It Seems is a fantastic song. Jeff wrote those lyrics. Is that a better song than Why Go? Maybe musically you might prefer it to be, but I don't know that lyrically it's better or worse. It's a tricky question. What do you think of that?
It is. I mean, I think the inclusion of 90% makes it a little easier for me to answer because there aren't a lot of instances where it's not 90% skewed in Eddie's favor as far as lyrical writing. Mm-hmm. I'm inclined to lean yes as well, mostly because when you think about the roles that every band member plays, those roles have evolved over time. But I think by and large, you know, Matt is still the drummer, you know, Eddie is still the singer, you know, Mike is still the lead guitarist, right? Stone still plays rhythm. And so, you know, Jeff obviously on the bass. And so I think that when I think about the albums and I think about song construction, you know, Eddie is at his best as a singer-songwriter. And, you know, Mike is at his best when he's shredding, right? Does that mean that Mike can't contribute lyrically to an album or that, you know, Matt Cameron can't bring music in? That he can't bring in a song like, you know, You Are or The Fixer or something that's nearly done, you know? of course not. I mean, I think some of Pearl Jam's best songs in the catalog come about that way, but I would probably say that, you know, if you asked me to put all these guys into a corner and say, this is what you're going to do on this record and this is what you're going to do on this record, I'd be hard pressed to find anyone that would look at, say, Jeff, for example, and say, you're writing all the lyrics, Jeff. You know what I mean? Well, even though too, I love the vague qualities of what he does sometimes, you know, he makes me work harder, you know, but the abstractness
also means that, you know, when you are not the singer, you can kind of edit along the way. You can say, hey, I've got these five lyrical ideas, but I think maybe this is the best one that has a chance to get on the record because Ed is so good. Like, you got to bring the goods because, again, Ed has to sing it. Yeah. If Ed's not vibing with it, he's not going to sing it. And that's not a judgment on the person. That's just if the meter isn't him or if the word choices aren't really him, it's going to be hard for him to emote what you're trying to say.
Right.
So that means that if you get a song on the record, that means that's a really good lyrical, not performance, but approach from you. So I think there's less pressure on the guys to put in lyrical, put in lyrics that are going to make it, but because they don't have to.
Not when you have Eddie Vedder holding the fork down in that regard.
It's not necessary. So if you do get one on there, then it's got to be really good. Basically, everything is going to be Ed approved. So the question is actually kind of null and void to a degree. I'm sorry, Ryan. All right, let's go with another one here. Let's go with all right, Stone Riff from Discord, one of our patrons. What is your Mount Rushmore of Pearl Jam? These are the four categories you've got to choose from. One band member, one riff the wine. One riff / solo, one lyric, and one live performance. Can you do
it? Okay. Oh, boy. All right. This is tough. All right. So, one band member, one live performance, one lyric, one riff, and solo. So, live performance, like a show or a single song?
I imagine one. I mean, well, Stone Riff isn't here to you know, elaborate. So just choose what you want. I think he meant song, but it could be a show.
Song. Okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
Just go. Man, that show's easier.
We'll go show. All right. I guess if I had to pick a that's basically like, what is the best Pearl Jam show of all time? I mean, I don't even know if that's.
We reserve the right to change our mind in 5 seconds.
Yeah. I reserve the right to change my mind based on new and compelling evidence.
There you go.
But Paul, all these shows have already happened, so none of them are new, and you've already heard all of them. True. Okay.
What's your point?
My point is this answer probably changes depending on what side of the
bed I wake up. No, I'm asking that person. What's the point?
Yeah. So, okay. I'm just going to pick a show, right?
Okay.
So, I mean, if I had to dig through this vault behind me here and just pull out a live Pearl Jam record, what's it going to be, right? Probably picking Atlanta 94 just because it's iconic.
Good choice.
It's from a great era of the band. It's missing Vitalogy, which, you know, most of Vitalogy, the vast majority of Vitalogy, but it's just a great, great set. I love the sound quality. And it was one of those shows that felt mythical to me because when I bought the Dissident single, like, you got some songs, right? And then suddenly I found out that there was a version of this show that was packaged as a Dissident single that was three discs that had everything, right? And,
he's digging through his collection right now, people. This is the silence.
And then I got it, right?
Oh, there
it
is.
That's right. Where I got it. So, you know, it's over time, like, I fell in love with the fact that I got this. You know what I mean? Look at that.
Trifold.
So, yeah, trifold. And it was kind of like a cool experience for me because it was a little bit of a precursor, like foreshadowing of what Pearl Jam records would eventually look like, you know, when they released them. You know, they wouldn't be plastic jewel cases for the foreseeable future, that they would actually evolve. So I think that particular show, that set, you know, it was pretty cool. I mean, obviously there are longer sets, Mansfield and so on, but I'd go with that show today. And if you ask me this time tomorrow, the answer probably changes.
Okay.
So I would say, okay, so there's the show. Lyric, gotta go with Black. I'm going to go with that lyric from Black that says, I know someday you'll have a beautiful life. I know you'll be a star in somebody else's sky, but why can't it be mine?
Mm-hmm.
That's right, always been the one that always resonated most for me. Favorite riff or solo? Oh, God. Riff or solo?
This is dicey.
That is really dicey. It's like almost, I mean, gosh.
There's no winning.
Gosh.
There's no winning.
No. There's so many amazing. It feels like it's cheating to say, like, Black again, because there's one. So many amazing. I guess.
Because either way, you're going to get
the Black solo.
Crucified.
I say the Black solo because, and I'm on record with this. I say this because it's arguably, to me, Eddie's greatest vocal performance. And somehow live, Mike has managed to match it in a way that feels like he has elevated the song and the song has been reimagined for a live audience in a way where Mike's guitar playing can carry it in ways that Eddie's voice can no longer. And that is an impressive feat to me. To be able to look at a song and say, well, this is, you know, some folks think this is the best thing you've ever done vocally and you're one of the most iconic vocalists of all time. Can I play something in a live version of this that makes people okay with the fact that you're not hitting this the same way you did 30 years ago, right? So I think that's impressive. So I'll go with that.
You've got
favorite,
band member,
not favorite, just band member. I got to pick a band member. Gosh.
Yeah.
Also impossible. My Mount Rush. It's hard to think of Pearl Jam without Eddie Vedder, but I'm not going to go with Eddie Vedder. I am going to go with Matt Cameron.
What?
And I say Matt, well, hear me out. Hear me out.
Okay.
Hear me out. And again, this will change tomorrow, right?
This is a TikTok cut.
Yeah. I say Matt Cameron because I think it's interesting to me that the band has had so many drummers and yet has persisted as long as it has. And Matt Cameron is the longest tenured, even though he's the one that joined the band later in life. And I think that there is a level of admiration and reverence that they have for his contributions that speaks volumes about what they think of him as a person. So I think that in the same way that Led Zeppelin folded when John Bonham died, in the same way that Keith Moon's passing had an indelible effect on that band, in the same way that any iconic drummer impacts a band, I think that Matt Cameron, that does not mean Matt Cameron is the only indispensable member of the band. I think that they, you know, it would be borderline unshakable if any of them were lost. But I think Matt Cameron just there's such an interesting narrative around everything about him. Plus, you know, he's also Soundgarden drummer, right? So like you get this double narrative where it's like, well,
I vote that you're cheating.
I am cheating. That's true. I am cheating.
Stone Riff. Okay, I'm gonna try and do this about 80% faster. Band members.
As you should.
I am going to do Sophie's Choice and take Stone Gossard. Because without his riffage, none of this happens. Not to say that without Jeff's riffage, none of this happens either, but you know, I gotta pick one. Riff solo. Main riff for Alive. It's
can't go wrong, though.
Might be the most iconic riff of the last 35 years outside of Enter Sandman. Lyric. I'm gonna go with Once Divided. Nothing subtract. Lyric. Yeah. And then live performance, if we're going shows, I'm gonna go with Soldier Field 95.
Oh, I like that choice.
It's got length, it's got girth, it's got a little bit of panache.
A little Brendan O'Brien there on the keys, too.
A little bit of Brendan O'Brien. It's got a radio broadcast. It's got a lot going on there.
Yeah.
Good show. All right, so you are up next. Pick another question, my friend.
All right, so that was a good one. That was a good one. Okay, let's see. This is from Ryan Finley on Instagram.
All right.
Ryan says, hey, Jason and Paul, love your podcasts. Thank you. We love you too, Ryan. And listen to you guys every week. Get excited to hear what Pearl Jam content you give us. I have a couple of Pearl Jam questions for you guys. Been listening to Of The Girl a lot. Can't figure out what that sound is at the beginning of the album version of that song. And I've always loved that sound ever since I was a little kid and was wondering if you guys know what they use to make that sound. In the event, Jason, we can't or don't answer that question, he has a follow-up, which was... Mm-hmm. When do you think the next single will be released for Dark Matter?
All right. So, as the producer of the show, I had privy to these questions beforehand. And so I said to myself, hey, I don't know. So I reached out to Ryan Lent and I said, Ryan, you know how to play Pearl Jam songs. What the hell is going on here? And he told me that he believes it is simply the metallic tones of Mike's resonator guitar with an overdrive pedal on it.
Okay.
So there you go.
I hope, Ryan, that satisfies your curiosity.
That's what his take is on that. As far as the second single goes, I think in some ways the band and management are, I wouldn't say surprised by Dark Matter's success, but I think... maybe taking a second to say, maybe we delay the second single a little bit from what we originally planned because it's doing this well. Let it breathe a little bit more. To Stone's point when he talked to Zosher about songwriting, like, let it breathe, maybe let it breathe. So I wonder if they had one, and we did the second single Time Machine just a couple of weeks ago, because generally speaking, you space them like 4 to 5 weeks out if you're pre-album, at least in this day and age. So I would have thought around now, but I'm going to say if the album comes out April 19th, I'm going to say that this is going to come out the first week of April. What do you think?
Okay. That's a good gauge.
Yeah.
I would imagine the third single comes out post album release, right?
At this point, yeah. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. So.
All right. All right. Paul on Facebook, Bevis, I forget how he pronounces it. Paul from Australia. Hey, Jason and Paul, so thankful I was able to be a part of your Australian fan roundtable episode ages ago.
All right.
That's right. Love the show. My question is, if you could only take three songs away with you on a deserted island, for the rest of your life, what would they be? And he does not specify they have to be Pearl Jam songs.
Oh, God.
So there's that.
Okay. Well, that's impossible. Three?
How much time you got, right, guys?
Well, I mean, yeah, let's see. There's so many. Again, I think this answer would change on a daily basis. The first three that come to mind, I'm going to go with Black by Pearl Jam. Mm-hmm. Probably Nothing Man, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, if I have to listen to these songs, it might as well be at least one, if not two, from my favorite band of all time. What do I do from there? God, you know, I'm tempted to go with the Led Zeppelin song. You know, my gut says Stairway to Heaven or something from Zeppelin, but I'm gonna throw a wild card in there because I need a little bit of diversity, right? It can't just be one genre. I'm gonna go Human Nature by Michael Jackson.
Ooh,
I think that the entire process behind the composition of that song is, it, first of all, it's a happy accident. If you don't know what I'm talking about, check out the 40-year documentary on Thriller, which I believe is on. Oh, hell, I don't know what it's streaming on. Look it up. But
it's streaming. There you go.
Streaming, yes.
Find it.
Anyway, so the story behind the song is fantastic, and it's just a beautiful, fantastic, magical pop song. And so I think, you know, with some rock influences, actually. Mm-hmm. So if you're a fan of the band Toto.
Rock influences,
it did. Yeah, yeah, it did. It did. So, yeah.
So those are your three?
Those would be my three.
Okay, I'm going to go with... God, this is, now that it's my turn, it's harder. Well, I have to do a Pearl Jam song, of course. I'm going to go with Breath. I always say that song. It's probably, you know, top two for me, at least. I am going to go with the song And Justice for All by Metallica.
Ooh.
I just think that's an absolute top, top song. And then I like your idea of going, off the rock path. And I am going to go with Superstition by Stevie Wonder.
Hey, good call. There's I could have busted out like a Sinatra song, you know, a jazz song, a Dinah Shore song. I mean, I have a wide, you know, depth and breadth of musical influences.
That's maybe we should do an episode one day where it's just like, what else is in the library? Because obviously we wax poetic about Pearl Jam a lot. And, you know, some of the bands, you know, in the purview of Pearl Jam, obviously that's the name of the game here, right? But there is some stuff, like what's the weirdest stuff in our collection that we listen to on a regular basis kind of thing, or a semi-regular basis. I think y'all would be interested to know that at some point. We'll see if we get there. All right. Okay, your turn, I think, right? Yeah.
That was a great question. That was a hard one. Okay, Marie_23 on Instagram. Marie asks, how and when did we meet each other, Jason? So do you want to take a stab at succinctly summarizing this, or shall I?
Well, we can
I could do it in five lines or less.
Five lines?
Let's see.
How and when did we meet? Okay.
Yes.
2008. Mm-hmm. The bar is called Jones. It's on Santa Monica Boulevard in West Hollywood, California.
John Wayne had drinks there.
What's up?
I said John Wayne, really? Among many other Golden Age stars.
Oh, I mean, yeah, it feels like one of those places that's been around forever. It's a really cool bar, and there's a spot. The bar is kind of like a U, you know, and there's booth seating around it, and then there's like a little lowered section with some tables. Like, it's a proper eatery, too, by the way. Good food. But behind the bar, the U actually continues, and it's almost like a not quite enclosed O. And back there, the very back of the bar, is like three or four seats that are kind of obscure. And that's where we were hanging out. And we were with other friends, and we got to talking. We're like, oh, hi, I'm so-and-so. Hi, I'm so-and-so. Hi, I'm so-and-so. And we met. And I don't know how Pearl Jam came up, but it came up. And that was that.
I think I asked you. Like, I think, really? You know, because I was there with a buddy of mine at the time, and you were there with a girlfriend, not like intimate girlfriend, but a friend who was
a lady.
Exactly. So we started just chatting because they were all talking, and you know, I only knew my one buddy there. So when he was off chatting with other people, and that the friend of yours that was a girl was dating my buddy, remember?
Oh, right.
Right. So they were dating. And so we were basically like kind of almost like fall into that third wheel track where it's like, well, all right, well. Like,
but there were two third wheels.
Yeah, exactly. Right. So we were a bicycle.
We
exactly.
I don't know what that means, but
Bicycle Thief, by the way, classic film. Check that out. Anyway, I think I asked you at one point, like, what kind of music you're into, and you mentioned Metallica, Pearl Jam. I told you how much I love Pearl Jam, and then floodgates open. It's like a fire hose. Just, there we go. Could not shut us up.
Yeah,
couldn't do it.
All right, let's see here. What else we got? What else we got? We did that. I'm checking these off as we go. Let's go with. Okay, Kyle from Facebook. Hey guys, been a Pearl Jam fan since 2017. And in November, I will get to see the band live for the first time when they're over here at the Gold Coast show. If you guys are good going to any of the shows, good for you, Kyle. If any of you are going to those shows or any shows on the tour, what songs do you really want the band to play? Cheers, Ozzy, Ozzy, Ozzy. I'm Paul. That's you.
What? Ozzy, 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 Ozzy. Ozzy. I don't. I'm missing.
Oi, oi, oi.
Oh God.
God, the internet is yelling at you right now.
Yeah, they are. They're just like.
Anyways,
who is this guy?
God. Okay, so the question though, what songs? I mean, we're both going to be in Los Angeles. We're both going to shows this year. What songs are we looking forward to see?
Well, I mean, you know, there's the easy answer is, you know, your favorite songs, right? So, I mean, I would love to hear Immortality, Black, Nothing Man, songs like that. Would love to hear as much of Dark Matter as possible, just because, you know, I only get to see them twice this tour. Only seen them in LA these two times for now, as far as I know. So it'd be great if between the two shows, I heard all of Dark Matter live, you know, spread out, which unlikely, but, you know, there's a,
you're probably
there's
get
a chance.
Most of it, though, I think.
Most of it. That's the hope.
Yeah.
I would say, aside from that, you know, what else would I like to see? Gosh, man. I mean, you could pull up the old Pearl Jam stat tracker, right? And say, hey, you know, what are those random songs off albums that I just have never heard? So I would probably have to go through the stat tracker in order to dig up a few that, you know, I don't necessarily have this amazing affinity for necessarily as much as I just want to be able to say I've heard every song live from every album.
Yeah.
But you know, something that's, I'd love to hear Around the Bend one day. Be super cool. Always loved that song. I'm at a point in my life where I really appreciate it a lot more than I did when it came out. I think that will be a lot of fun. I think I would really enjoy hearing, this is, people are going to hate me for the sleight of hand. If they, you know, if they're bringing out, you know, a bunch of new gear to accommodate the new sounds on this record, I'd be very curious how much of it allows them to explore a greater soundscape with a song like Sleight of Hand. Cause I feel like there's some really cool stuff happening on Binaural that was never truly captured live.
Yes.
I wouldn't mind to hear, I'd love to hear Hold On. B-side Hold On. Always loved that song. I've never had a chance to hear that one live. Those are the ones off the top of my head that come to mind immediately. Of the Girl, love that. It'd be just, you know, a great opener too.
We got lucky with that last time in a way.
We did. We did.
Well, speaking of Binaural, I famously missed that tour. I'm not going to get into that. But I would say if they could play a number of songs off of, or at least a couple off of Binaural that I haven't heard, that would be super. And I mean, like,
that'd be big for you.
Rival, I'd love to hear Rival, never heard it before. I've heard Breakerfall, but I'd love to hear it again. Alone, would love to hear Alone.
Yeah, that'd be really nice.
I have heard that, but it's been, I think I only heard it once, and that was almost 20 years ago now.
Okay.
What else? What else? What else? I love Long Road. Around the Bed's a great shout. In Hiding. Haven't busted that out too often, you know? So stuff like that. I think I've pretty much heard everything off of Backspacer, Avocado, although I would love to hear Inside Job or Comeback or Army Reserve. Ooh, Army Reserve. There you go.
Good call. Right, I'd love to hear Severed Hand, too. Severed Hand, I would love to hear that one.
That would be... God, we would name like 15 million songs. Yeah, a lot of songs, Kyle. A lot of songs. All right. So you are up, Paul.
Okay. So let's see. Let's go with Simone. Simone from Discord. Hi, Simone. Simone asks, if you each got to be a guest band member for one song at one show, what song would it be? And would you want to sing along or play an instrument or just dance?
Well, if I had a heads up, like if I knew like 48 hours in advance that I was going to get to go up on the stage and play a song with the guys, I would definitely learn a Pearl Jam song front to back. I mean, I know some sort of, I know lots sort of, but not all the way through, not like really good. If it was just like plucked out of a crowd, Rockin' in the Free World, because that's easy. I already know that front to back. Yeah. If that's like it's like two different sections, off you go, 9 minutes later, having a blast. But I feel like if I had the time, it would be something I should say guitar. I think I implied that, but I would play guitar. And I feel like Rearview Mirror would be fun. I feel like Porch would be fun. Both songs that are not terribly difficult to play, but you get an indeterminable amount of time in the interlude to jam with those guys. And that would be worth the price of admission. So I'd probably lean towards one of those two songs purely so I could just make it, I could extend my time for as long as possible. I'm not choosing looking, let's put it that way.
God. I'd love to go crazy on a mic with Eddie at the end of Jeremy. That'd be fun.
Ooh, great shout.
I mean, that would be cool. yeah, exactly. I think the only other one that really stands out to me is Alive. Not that I would want to sing it or play it, but I would want to have that
tambourine.
That perspective. Well, the tambourine, obviously, right? I'd like to be the one throwing tambourines, you know, since I was there on the receiving end with my wife when she caught one. But more importantly, one of my favorite moments in a Pearl Jam show is when we've been fortunate enough to be pretty close up on the floor. And the times that I have, I never take for granted the opportunity to turn around when everyone is, you know, going, hey, you know, at the end. And just you turn around and you just see a sea of tens of thousands of people just all doing this in unison. And it's just the community and the uniformity and the just the bonding that you see, you know, it's just this kinetic energy. And it's such a cool view, you know, but to be up there on stage with the band and experiencing it from that angle and up on stage, just it'd be pretty cool. So I would probably have to say that one as well.
Yes, I like that. And I mean, your point about looking behind you, I think I have a photo from like the last three or four times I've been on the floor for Live of that moment, because it always is like, I should film Mike, but then I go turn my phone around, catch everybody else. All right, let's do Farls, our main man from Discord. He says, what cover would you most like to see Pearl Jam record next? Been a while since the likes of Love Rain or Me or charity singles like Last Kiss. Time for something new, methinks.
Yeah, I agree. A cover. Well, you got to think about Ed's voice. You know, it'd be cool if they did a cover of like Bad Company.
Feel like
just Paul Rogers. That's the band, but I mean, actually, the song, you know, Bad Company, I think would be really, really cool. Don't Fear the Reaper. I mean, can you imagine Mike doing the solo from Don't Fear the Reaper? Ooh. I love Metallica's version of Astronomy. Yeah. I mean, Pearl Jam, that'd be pretty cool. But I mean, Don't Fear the Reaper, I think, would be pretty, pretty epic. That one stands out to me as a really cool cover. I'm trying to think of something that just crushes, you know. I've never heard them do Stairway, have you?
Oof. I don't know that you can hit those notes.
Yeah, you probably can't. Too much falsetto there. I don't know. You know, I say that, but then you listen to Heart do a cover of that song with Bonham's Kid at the Kennedy Center Honors. Mm. And it's not like she's, you know, going super high. I mean, she's just yelling. I don't know. It was beautiful. It's an amazing, amazing cover of that song.
You know, they did Draw the Line by Aerosmith in Boston in 2016. And there are some higher parts in that song. And of course, Steven Tyler can really get up high.
Yeah.
But I feel like Aerosmith is kind of one of those bands that they could really pluck a, maybe not Sweet Emotion, but like Toys in the Attic.
Dream On.
No. Well, Dream On is great, but I don't know.
Back
in the Saddle. That'd be fun. Yeah. Train get the rolling all night long. That'd be fun. Yeah. Ooh. Train get the rolling all night long.
Yeah.
You know what'd be fun is a Boston song.
Anything off that debut album.
Yeah. That'd be great.
More Than a Feeling.
Hitching a Ride.
The whole crowd would get into that. That'd be
cool. My goodness. Yeah, there's too many Farrells. There's too many.
Too many.
All right. What else
great is next? Question. Okay. Let's see. So I will say that Marie had also asked if we, Marie23 on Instagram had asked, just going to quickly hit this, you know, does our family find this a little bit intrusive? You know, why we decided to create the podcast. So we've talked about why in the sense that, you know, Jason already had a podcast, wasn't music related. And he had been, you know, bandying around the idea with me of wanting to do this, but I was so maxed out with work and life. I didn't have time. And, once COVID hit, I suddenly had time and I figured what the heck, but, you know, as far as the family is concerned, invasive. I mean, sure, there's times where it encroaches a little bit on family time, but I think that Jason and I do a really good job of trying to make it just a regular part of our routine. And I don't think it's intrusive in the way that it takes time away from our families. You know, we do prep. It's far more time for Jason than it is for me, because I mean, he's editing the episodes. He does a lot of the show notes because he has a producer background. He does a great job promoting it. I mean, you know, he's the one that, you know, by and large, just, you know, fetches the guests, dangles out the fishing lines, as it were. So I would say that, you know, your answer, Jason, to this may differ from mine a little bit. But I do think that because it's gone from a labor of love to something that clearly to our family is not just a labor of love, but like there's a real passion for us and it fills our bucket. I think that when you have family that loves you and they see that it makes you happy, it's really no different than, you know, the family member that loves to golf every Saturday for 6 hours, right? Or the family member who loves to go work out for 2 hours, or, you know, to go on a hike every weekend with girlfriends, or, you know, whatever it happens to be. So this just happens to be our jam, you know? So I'm not,
this is the hobby
balancing this podcast with, you know, 9 other hobbies. You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's, I mean, this has become the hobby over the last 4 years. I mean, obviously when we started this, it was the pandemic. So like going to the movies wasn't a thing. And I can count on one hand the number of movies I've seen in the theater since then. But you know, like you with, you know, the Giants or the Niners or whoever, you know, I still watch my sports teams. I still make a point to, like, even if I'm DVRing it and like avoiding my phone for 3 or 4 hours, I am watching all my teams. And then Marie did ask me also, how am I an Arsenal fan? And maybe I'll answer that in a bit. But I watched the game today as I'm recording this, and we're through to the quarterfinals of the Champions League. Yes. But outside of like watching my teams and you watching your teams, this has just replaced whatever was the free time / hobby that was there before. And
in a lot of ways it has.
What's funny is like a lot of that was probably spent on message boards talking about the band anyway.
Yeah.
So
just made it a more productive way of doing it.
Exactly.
And fulfilling, you know, for us anyway.
Yeah. And here's the other thing too, you know, with the vacuum of COVID, and by vacuum I mean like I couldn't do my craft. I am a TV producer person by trade. That's been my life for the last 18 years, 19 years. I needed something to do to like, you know, you've got a muscle and you've got to like use that muscle, right? And so that was the impetus of this. Let's have these conversations. And I can use my producing muscle and we can just put something out there and hopefully people will like it. And, you know, we're nearly 4 years on from that. We're just shy of 4 years and we're 200 episodes into it. And it is a lot of work. I will say, fortunately, my family are super supportive, as are Paul's.
And we are very grateful to them for that.
Absolutely. And I am fortunate that my job is so, it's flexible from a scheduling point of view. And there are moments within that time period where I'm there, where there are little, I don't want to call them lulls, but I have an opportunity to go and check and say, hey, can I look at this thing? Can I check 20 minutes of audio now? Can I go and do some prep on this lyric now and maximize my time while I'm there? Because when I get home, it might be 11:30 at night and I'm just going to go to bed, or I'm going home to family.
So I'm going to bounce to another quick question here, because that wasn't the one I initially
knew. Oh, okay.
This is MB on Twitter. we got sidetracked there.
Yeah.
Will Comes Then Goes make a set list, or maybe get more of the Earth this tour? I don't think we will hear Of the Earth, and I do not think we will hear Comes Then Goes. I feel like we will eventually hear that song, but it could be 10 years from Gigaton before we do. I'm not convinced that there's been enough healing for them to, I mean, there's a reason it wasn't played at the last tour, and whatever that reason was, I'm not convinced that there's been enough that needs to happen for that song specifically to make an appearance on this tour. That's what I would say.
I would say that as far as Of the Earth is concerned, we might see a moment at some point in the next 5 years where they pull one of those Pearl Jam moves where they just pluck it out for one show, just for S's and G's.
Be fun. Be cool.
Which would be great, but I wouldn't hold your breath on that. And then as far as Comes and Goes, yeah, I think Paul's right. I think that song is way too personal to them, and I think that that's the kind of song that maybe Ed does by himself, because it's basically by himself anyways, at some sort of like, I don't know, benefit thing in like 15 years. It's like, you know, we haven't seen him in like 5 years. It's just for public. One of those kind of like strangely unique performances that's like, if this was going to be the moment, it's going to be now kind of thing. Whereas like now there's too many opportunities where he could play it. And it's like, I'm going to keep it. I'm going to keep it for myself. I'm going to keep it for ourselves. So I don't think they're going to play it.
Okay.
Let me cross that one off so I don't repeat it. Let's see what else we got here. How about Stip? How about our good friend Stip? I say from Patreon, but really just from being buds. He's got a few here. Here's the first one. He says, congrats on 200 episodes. Thanks, Stip. Love you. Mean it. What song, album, period, or element of Pearl Jam has changed the most for you because of the podcast?
That's a really good question. I would say probably the what period or album? I mean, I feel like right around the time we started with this, I was really starting to dive deeper into albums like Binaural and Riot Act and say, okay, these weren't as accessible, but you know, let's work a little bit. I think that Avocado is probably an album that the podcast have forced me to revisit a lot more than I may otherwise not have revisited. So I would probably say that those albums there. If I had to pick one, I'd say Avocado. Because I feel like that 2006 tour in that era, I don't want to say it's lost to history, but I feel like the band seemingly got lost to a lot of fans with Riot Act, and then found something with Avocado, but it wasn't until Backspacer that we really started to see this renaissance, if you will. I mean, you know, they had string players on tour with them. It was a super short album in terms of TRT.
It takes time for people to recognize a wave.
It had a hit single. It had the, you know, In the End and Just Breathe as well with The Fixer. I feel like it was kind of like a rebirth of Pearl Jam as a new era of their lives, you know, where they were. And I feel like sometimes Avocado gets lost in the shuffle as a precursor to that. So I think this podcast has helped reshape my perspective on that record.
I would say that there are a number of songs across the catalog that I didn't give enough time to lyrically. And I feel like I point that out almost every lyric of the week that we do.
Yeah.
Save You comes to mind. But even stuff early. You know, even stuff off of maybe Black or Rearview Mirror. Like, stuff that I've sung a million times before, but never really dove into the poetry of it. And like I mentioned earlier with Dark Matter, King Diamond to Discard. You break that thing down, it's like, dude, there's a couple of things happening here that I didn't really pick up on. Like, I get the knee-jerk superficial reaction to that line. I know what he's saying, but like, there's obviously layers to it, and there's a lot of lines like that over the catalog where I kind of knew what he meant or what vibe he was going for, or attitude he was trying to emote, and but didn't really go farther than that.
Right.
I've admitted to being a music first guy for a long time, but the music isn't rocking. It's hard for me to even care about the lyrics. I have to really enjoy the music first, rocking or softer or whatever. And then the lyrics are the enhancer, or it was for a long time. But the lyric of the week segment for us, having to do that, and I say having to, doing that has forced me to then really revisit some of these things and dive into what they really mean. And that's been huge. Because now I have a greater appreciation for a lot of songs that I was like, oh, that's fine, you know? So I think that's been the biggest thing with the podcast.
Good stuff.
Yeah.
Also from Stip, Paul, where would you be, Paul, if you had Jason's luxurious flowing locks? Well, you have since cut those locks, if I recall. Yeah,
they're gone.
Yes, you have. Gone. There they are.
Gone. I've cut them off.
Luxurious locks. Yeah. Samson, no more, are you? I'm not a fan of the way I look with really long hair. My wife loves it on me. It drives me nuts. So I would say I feel like it just grows out, never drops. So easy answer to that.
It drops down. You got a good quaff.
Where would I be? I would be in a perpetual state of annoyance. That's where I would be. Okay, different question. Stone Riff from Patreon. You were given the time, say about 12 months, and a contract. Okay, take a year off from your normal job. Write a book that's Pearl Jam related, biographical, journalistic, fan perspective, any specific thing, something loosely related, fictional, whatever you want to do. What would you write about and why? Well, first of all, there are some great Pearl Jam books already out there, one of which is all about fans. And it's a photographic journey of their experiences and the songs that they love. It's fantastic. We profiled it.
Tanya.
That's right. Love it. I would say that the book that I want to say is a book that someone else is writing that I'm very excited about. So yeah. And I'm thrilled that it's this person writing this book, because I cannot think of a more perfect author for this kind of book. So for me as a writer, what would it be? I would probably go fiction. I would probably write a fictional Pearl Jam experience.
What would that try to tie arc in. Be?
Oh God, I don't
Dave
know.
Dave Cruz never leaves.
Probably be a life, like a journey of someone's life, and how Pearl Jam's music keeps providing these intersections for these pivotal points. You know, I harken back to something Lenny said from Black Circle, where he talked about how Pearl Jam was the soundtrack of his life, that he could think of so many pivotal moments in his life, and there was a Pearl Jam song that was part of it, or a Pearl Jam song that captures it. So I would probably want to write a work of fiction that heavily revolves around Pearl Jam as a band and the music that they've made. And it would have an accompanying soundtrack. So that would be my answer to that.
Well, then the follow-up then is, what's on that soundtrack? Don't answer that. I can't answer that question. I'm not really a writer. Paul's the writer. I could give you like a one sheet of an idea that I'd make Paul do, or you know, like hire him to do. I mean, listen, all the answers that we're seeking, whether it's through the conversations that we all have together, whether it's through the interviews that the band does, you know, someday, obviously, it'd be great if we could ask some of those questions to them. A lot of that we're never going to know. A lot of that we're never going to know. So I think in lieu of not being able to know what so-and-so was thinking when XYZ happened, and we're all very curious people, in lieu of that, I think we have a number of books out there that are already very good at kind of timelining the band and offering a take on a genre or an era. Renan Govney has one. Stephen Hayden has one. You know, there's a few of them out there for sure. But I think Stip has one coming out. I think it's second half of this year. He's got one coming out.
Mm-hmm.
It's a song by song interpretation with some, I think he might have his own, you know, signature live versions of kind of section of that. And I think that's the book that I would read, that I would want to read. So
yeah,
I know I'm shilling for him, but it's real. That's the kind of book that I would want to read.
That's what I was referencing, by the way.
Yeah. It's called I Am No Guide, by the way. You can pre-order it now. I'll put the link in the description of everything, but it's going to be, I've read parts of it. It's great. It's great.
It's epic.
All right, let's see here. What else we got?
How about that Brad Arendelle question?
I'm looking at that right now.
Yeah.
Let's go with Brad. Brad Arendelle from Australia and Facebook. Hey guys, mm-hmm. which songs would you like the band to shake up a little live this year? Perhaps even something they've done before, like the changing tempo drum fills we used to get in Alive, or the way that Porch Jam would progress.
Yeah, I mean, like reworking a song, right?
Mm-hmm.
I feel like when they do it and it works well, WMA, the way they reworked that was really, really cool. So I would say I'd love them to go back to No Code. You know, we don't have Jack with us, and I feel like Matt is a very different drummer than Jack Irons. So I'd love them to take some of those songs off of No Code and rework them in ways that feel a little bit more like a Pearl Jam song with the band as it's currently constructed. And that's not a slight on Matt or on Jack. I mean, I adore those songs, but it'd be a fun exercise. You know what I mean? In the same way that, you know, we don't have Dave to play WMA. But the way that they would rework that song with Stone on guitar, I thought was really cool. It was a fresh take on that music. So why not attempt some fresh takes on songs from No Code or even Binaural, maybe, you know, with some of the new stuff that they have at their disposal now. So that's what stands out the most.
I think No Code's the right choice, because I think before that you're getting into songs that if you really changed it up would be almost sacrilegious. And I say that because if you recall, Ed and the Earthlings completely rejiggering Corduroy. There was like a COVID benefit thing at SoFi Stadium. I don't remember what it was for, but they showcased that, and I was like, I don't know about that. And then, but even within the band, when the last 5 or 6 years, wherever it's been, where they've kind of elongated the bridge. It made it like a sing-song call and response thing, and like there's like an added mic solo. Like, I am not for that. I think it completely kills the momentum of the song. Just my opinion. I guess they want to make everything very interactive, but I don't like that.
Yeah.
So I think, go to No Code. And Matt, what would you do here? And all deference to Jack, because those songs are fabulous as they are, but wouldn't it be fun if they were going to mess around with something?
Yeah.
Mess around with one of those songs. All right. We're getting a little long in the tooth here, so let's go to the ending of our... We have a few questions here that kind of pivot us perfectly. This is from Farrells, again, from Discord. And this is a quick fire. This is rapid fire, lightning round. Now, Paul, we can work together on this, according to Farrells' rules, between the two of us. We have to come to an accord on the answer to these five queries.
Okay.
10 or yield?
That's a pick?
We have to pick one.
10.
And he says, oh, okay. I agree. He said, yes, I know yield couldn't exist without 10, but play along anyways. Yes, I would just still say 10.
Okay.
10. Okay. Concert posters or shirts?
Posters.
Posters for me too. Uncle Neil or Brendan O'Brien?
Brendan O'Brien.
That's hard. Without Neil, I don't know that there is a Pearl Jam.
Yeah, but I mean,
are we
I
saying think about we the act one of them now, or they just never? I think he's saying they never existed, kind of thing.
Maybe I don't know. Either way, I mean, I think that there's just something about Brendan's impact on the band and his stewardship that.
But without Neil's mentorship, they might not get past Vitalogy. Hmm. I'll go Uncle Neil just for S's and G's, just to play devil's advocate here. Binaural or avocado?
Avocado.
I'm going to go by neural.
Okay. I knew you picked the... I'm going to read all those yesterdays or 7 o'clock. And there's no escape hatch for either one of us here. Is
no,
there,
this is just brutal.
No, there's not. I'm going to go 7 o'clock if those are my choices.
I mean, yeah. All those yesterdays, 100%.
Yeah.
All those paper plates, Paul.
Yep.
Oh, my God.
Okay, very little consensus from us there.
All right, DT Lob from Discord and Simone from Discord all both asked similar questions, so I'll kind of put them into one. Basically, what's coming? What's in store for the next 100, 200 episodes? Simone asks specifically, I'm curious what your focus and goals were when you first started the podcast and how they've evolved and what have you enjoyed the most and what do you want to do more of?
I mean, I've enjoyed the community and, you know, and the opportunities to just talk to people and learn and grow and, just have great conversations about music. You know, I love music and to be able to not just talk with people who love music, but people who have created some of the music that has affected me so much, but also to be able to talk to people who have profiled the band and worked with the band and, you know, connected with the band, been impacted by the band, are inspired by the band. All that stuff's great. You know, the sense of community. Next 100 to 200. Gosh, I mean, first of all, look what we're doing now. You know, like 200 episodes ago, we didn't have a YouTube channel. You know, there was no visual component to this. So I would say that the show's evolving. The show's growing. I think that there's an opportunity for us to expand. We have a Discord now. You know, we have a community within a community, which mm-hmm. I think is amazing. I mean, I'll be honest, like sometimes I just pop in and I just, you know, enjoy, like literally while we are recording this episode, the members of our Discord are building a set list right now.
Are they still going?
I keep getting updates on the phone. I think it's still going. Yeah, I just saw some.
Oh, they're at 19. Comfortably now.
At 19, yeah. Well, so I'm there. Can I chime in? You know what I mean? Like there's
live?
you should.
Okay, 20. This is, we're in the encore now. 20. I'm gonna go alone.
There you go. Good call.
There you go. Mid show.
Something that. we're both hoping to hear on this tour.
Yeah.
Anyway, so what comes next? I mean, I think that we are excited to expand what the show is and what the show can do. And I mean, obviously, you know, there are lots of folks that we are still excited about having on the show to talk to, but more importantly than that, I think it's just what the show represents to everybody and the community. And, you know, like I said, it really has become an extension of the Pearl Jam community. Thanks to all of you, by the way.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're just here, you know, driving the boat, so to speak. So, I would say that the next 100 episodes from my point of view, Jason, really are just about taking the show to a new level and seeing where we can go from here.
Yeah. Focus and goals when we first started were to simply just talk about the band that we loved and hope that some people would appreciate maybe those listen. Kinds of yeah. points that we're making and those experiences and create a little bit of a community and get some people to listen yeah. and like what we had to say and be like, oh yeah, I agree with that. Or I don't agree with that. Here's why. And that was the initial goal. And we, you know, we didn't know shit from shit when it came to like putting a podcast together. But since then, 200 episodes later and seeing the community that I don't want to say that we've built, but that we have, people, the community, part of the community has found us and mm-hmm. have invited us into their lives by way of us,
which is
opining about shit that everyone's talking about. Like I keep finding new people who are like on Facebook yesterday, someone was like, oh, a Pearl Jam podcast. Cool. And I was like, hey, new friends. Like,
yeah, right.
There are some bands that have been around for a number of years and I'm just hearing about them now. And it's not anyone's fault. There's a band who they're an unbelievable band name, by the way. Their name is Pissed Jeans. They're a punk band. They have six albums. I didn't know them until 3 weeks ago. New album just came out. It's a lot of fun. And, nice. But like, I'm six albums late, right?
Mm-hmm.
So some people, mm-hmm. come on, algorithms, let's go, you know,
right.
Haven't quite found our portion of the community. And I just want to be everybody's friend. Really? I just want to, you know, we go to the shows and we meet people and they're so much fun to talk to. And that's all I want to do. I just want to have these conversations with people. And it started with me and Paul. And I was hoping that more people will come under the tent and more people have. And that's always been the goal. And I think what we've noticed over the last 6 to 8 months is that we enjoy this so much that we want to spread this to other bands, other parts of the world. Yeah. You know, having conversations with people like Kevin Martin with Candlebox, or James Joseph from James and the Cold Gun, or Zosher, or Mark Arm from Mudhoney. There's a number of other bands and other artists that I'm like dying to talk to because they have served such a great purpose in my musical journey. You know, if I could talk to Mike Ness from Social Distortion, oh my God. If I could talk to, and by the way, some of these new bands, I've seen in the comments for the Zosher episode, I didn't know about this guy. This is amazing. I love learning about new music.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
So maybe Pearl Jam becomes the fulcrum, right? Yeah.
The bedrock. Right.
We'll always be a Pearl Jam.
Yeah. That's always going to be the North Star. Don't worry about Pearl Jam. It's always going to be the North Star. But like, what comes of it? What else can we talk about? What else is it? I mean, we have a part of our Discord channel. That's one of the channel, our Discord server. One of the channels is non-PJ music. And I learned about a new artist just the other day. Boom. Go check them out. I found a band on KEXP. Put the link to their YouTube video on that channel. People are like, oh shit, this is great. That's what we're talking about.
Yeah.
That's what gets me fucking rock. I don't want to say the next word. That's what gets me so excited. Is like building this out. You know, the people are there. It's about shining the light on them through the little shows that we do. If that makes any sense at all.
Does.
Yeah.
It does.
That's what we're trying to do in the next couple hundred episodes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, we appreciate all of your questions and we look forward to the next version of this, whenever the hell that is. But we're gonna move on to a segment we haven't done in a little while. It's a bedrock of this show, Paul. And that is
Good segue.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I've learned from the best. That is the lyric of the week. Okay, lyric of the week this week. There are like three songs left that we haven't done. This is one of them, and that song is from Vitalogy, and it's Bugs.
I see this around me, I see them deciding my fate.
Okay, Paul, so that was like a part close to the end of the song, but honestly, we can just talk about the whole damn thing. Bugs. We're talking about bugs. Give me your lyrical breakdown, my friend, your analysis.
Well, I mean, I just think it's, you know, the parasitic quality of the music industry at the time. and how, you know, Eddie felt like he was no longer in control of his own fate, how, you know, the powers that be were trying to decide for him, you know, what his identity was, what his music was meant to be, what it was supposed to achieve, how much it was supposed to sell. And I think the band, you know, were at a crossroads in their career, which we've, you know, talked about at length. But when I think of this song, I still listen to it all the way through. I actually enjoy it as a as part of the record.
Yeah,
you know, because when I listen very to that key song, I can't listen to it in it. You it's part of the experience of Vitology. Like, you listen to it within context of the rest of the record, and I think it has a lot of weight behind it. You know, so when I hear the record, I experience a record that showcased the band at a point in their career where they were trying to find their way. They were in some respects, you know, starting to come apart at the seams, right? They had just parted ways with Dave and, you know, they were tired. I mean, you know, they wrote this record basically on the Versus tour, right? And then they were touring for this, you know, and then they were gonna kind of trying to find some stability with Jack in the fold shortly thereafter. But I think Jack was here for this, wasn't he? Was he here for Bugs? Or was it
I think he was here for the very, very last
part. Very tail end of the recording.
Yeah, tail end.
But I mean, Eddie was already in that frame of mind, you know?
100%. So,
and to me, like, as silly of an exercise as in a big middle finger that Bugs was to the record industry at the time, I do think that it is a song. You know what I mean? It's not an interlude like some of these other things on Vitology. It's an actual song. Whether or not you want to take it serious or not is up to you. But I mean, it's a song.
Yeah. I mean, I think a lot of people would say that it's plausibly just one of those bridges, you know, just connecting one song to the next, an experiment of the bored and or high or drunk. but honestly, they were in such a weird place and Ed was in such a weird place that it always seemed way more intentional than that. Even when I was younger, it felt more intentional. And that's key.
Yeah,
it's not like, I don't want to besmirch the good name of Red Dot as an example, but like that was one of those things where it's like, hey, we got this little thing, let's just kind of throw it in there. Like, it obviously wasn't like a fully fleshed out. It was just like a let's get from A to B kind of thing. This isn't that. And Aya Davinita and Pry 2 are also not that. They're intentional. And that was the point of the record. The record was intentional. And you hit it there with you know, Ed dealing with fame and grappling with that. And you always talk about this album being their white album.
And this I believe that.
Yeah, this is like a big reason why. A song.
Not their Revolution 9, but, you know, it's.
Yeah.
it's part of that, you know, it's part of the experimentation that
right.
you see on the white album.
And I think it was taking a. I mean, I don't think it was taking a musical risk to do that. It's a droning two chord on the accordion passage for nearly 3 minutes. Yeah. And, you know, but it's Ed. This is so Ed of that time.
Yeah.
And you said it about, you know, think about what is a bug? A bug can be, you know, someone listening in on you. It could also be a parasite, as you said. So it's got the two meanings going for it. And I think that he probably felt like he was being watched with all the media scrutiny that he had. And, you know, he felt like he was the center of everyone's focus, even if he didn't mean to be or didn't want to be. And that's got to make your skin crawl, a.k.a. Bugs. And so how do you cope with those feelings? And I think he coped with them by writing the feelings through a metaphor of bugs actually infesting his room. And it's kind of brilliant. In a weird way, but like, again, this is to who asked the question? Was it Stone Riff? I forget who it was. You know, what's one of the things, maybe it was Stip actually, what's one of the things that you learned or you appreciated more from doing the podcast? Yeah, I would have really sunk my teeth into Bugs, like really line by line as I did for this. And I knew what it was about really, but like line by line. If it wasn't for the show. And like you get to pull out some of these lines and it's just like, oh, that is wild. Like, I actually forgot about the last couple of lines where he goes, was I'm naked and now we're one. Like, I forgot about the naked right. line. Like, what the hell is going on? It's a really interesting little, what's what I'm looking for? Not microscope into his world, but like, you know,
microcosm. It's well, like it, a microcosm, it was a microcosm. Of, what, I was like, of his frame of mind at the time.
Yeah.
Or a conduit or a window into his.
A window. There you go. That's why I was searching for the word window. I have no idea. But yes, it is a microcosm and a window into the time. And I think that it's very interesting. And somehow, I think if 12-year-old me had really given the whole album a chance, I wonder what I would have thought. But when I finally gave it a chance, a few years later, I did recognize that while this was super weird, it did feel intentional.
It does. And it is.
It took me a while to realize why, but now we all know why. And hopefully, hopefully you all know why as well. So we have to do a live cut of this thing, don't we, Paul?
We do. We actually have a couple to choose from, ironically.
My goodness. All right, well, let's go then and choose our live cut of the week.
Ready to stand up!
Okay, so live cut of the week. We've got three. We've got 2009 Philadelphia. We've got 2012 in Amsterdam, and we've got 2013 in Chicago. Take me through these, Paul.
I mean, all three have their virtues, you know, whether it's Ed on the guitar, which is an interesting take, or the fan interaction, you know, which I think is super cool. But I think ultimately you put Ed on an accordion with a string accompaniment. Mm-hmm. Hard to beat that, right? We're going Philly, 2009.
String players, if I stop, just keep playing.
Okay. I got bugs. I got bugs in my room. Bugs in my ears. There are eggs in my hair. Bugs in my pockets. Bugs in my shoes. Bugs in the way I feel about you. Bugs on my window, trying to get in. They don't go nowhere. They're just waiting, waiting. Bugs on my ceiling, crowded the floor. Standing, sitting, kneeling. You blocked the door, and now the questions: do I kill them or become their friend? Do I eat them raw, well done? Do I trick them? I don't think they're that dumb. Do I join them? Oh, it looks like that's the one. I got bugs on my skin, tickle my nausea. Or let it happen again. They're always taking over. I see them surround me. I see them deciding. Oh, that which was once was up to me. Oh, now it's too late. I got bugs in my room, one on one. That's when I had a chance. I'll just stop now. I'll become naked, and with them, I'll become one.
Yeah. I think that's the winner for sure. I was really taken by the Amsterdam version. The fact that he did it on the guitar was strange, but Amsterdam crowd ate it up. And then Chicago, he did the accordion again, but the performance wasn't as strong. There's no string section, and it's an audience recording because for whatever reason, that first Wrigley Field show has not been released officially. So it made the Philly, by the way, Halloween night, shutting down the Spectrum last night at the Spectrum, night 4 of 4.
Perfect. So perfect.
I think the Phillies.
And he was so ominous in his delivery, right? He was so ominous the way he was saying it. It's perfect.
It really was the perfect way to do it. So easy pick. Not much to say about it, but that. So there you go. October 31st, 2009, the Spectrum, Philly. If you were there, raise your hand. I can't see it, but type yes or hit thumbs up or something like that in the comments. That's the show, guys. 200 down, a million more to go. All thanks to you. Are you thumbs upping, thumbs downing that?
I was 200 down and 200 more to go.
I took that thumb down very differently. I'm glad that you
you
explained it. If you guys want a little bit more out of this show, there is Patreon. There is extra content there, bonus episodes, discounted merchandise, giveaways. Where the hell did it go? Giveaways. That thing. Where is it? There it is. Paul's got it. This is what it looks like. March's giveaway. Final copy of Dark Matter, the single. And other than that, I'd love for you to go ahead and rate. Well, you say it. You always say it good.
Rate, review, and subscribe on your before.
I totally jinxed you.
I butchered it. It's all right. We'll fix it in post. Rate, review, and subscribe in your preferred podcast platform of choice.
And if you're on YouTube, you can go ahead and like this video, subscribe to the channel, hit the bell icon, whatever the hell else YouTube wants you to do, so that other fans can find this content and join the conversation. Because, like we said before, it's all about bringing everybody in under the tent.
It is.
The tent can grow. The tent is like your epidermis. It can keep on growing. It is a beautiful organism, an organ that expands infinitely. All right. Where am I going with this? Nobody knows.
200 in, and this is what we've become.
This is what we've got. Well, it's a party. It's a party, guys.
Come on. One.
Very well done. Very nice.
Echo Eddie's words in our most recent.
Also, I'm going to get naked. So just.
All right. No, we're signing off.
I'm kidding. We'll be back with you next week for episode 201 and more hijinks ahead of this Dark Matter release. And until we do. You've been listening to
The State of Love and Trust.